Why was it reissued?
Well, it's actually been a tradition, I think, at Disney to release the animated, re-release the animated films every 7 or 8 years for a new generation. Even, as we said, growing up, I saw Pinocchio when I was about 10 years old, and that was probably the most inspiring film that I saw as a child, and that's really the reason I got into animation. But that wasn't seeing the original release, which was quite a few years before. That was a re-release, and many people have seen many of these films in re-release. The only difference with The Little Mermaid, I think, is that it went on to videotape shortly after it was out in theaters. And I think there was some question, once it's gone to videotape, can it still be re-released in theaters again? I think we always hope so, because there's something very unique about seeing these movies in a theater with an audience, and that's a very special way. And that's really the way they're ultimately designed to be experienced. So it's great for us, I mean, to see the film come out again in theaters, and I hope that will continue for future re-releases, because we'd like these films to always have a chance to be seen in theaters.
They did remix the soundtrack for surround sound now with the improved sound technologies today, so that you could get a fuller, richer sound from all sides of the theater. And there's been a little done with the visuals where they did some, no scenes were added or anything like that, but there was some tweaking of some scenes where there's some technical imperfections or paint that was sort of bubbling or boiling on some of the cells, where they sort of fixed that and put highlights on the bubbles where they had missed it originally. A little finishing touches, sort of like that.
Were you personally involved in this re-release?
Yeah, we were. The mix was done by the same sound mixer that worked on it this past summer now, and Ron was there hearing that on the stage, and then we both looked at the reels as they came through the sort of digital restoration thing.
Yeah, it's an odd thing to be working on a film again after you think you're done with it, basically. Yeah. But an animator, you're never done. It's like, probably if it's re-released 8 years from now, there'll be more to do. So it's an odd thought, because it's like I say, it's nice to have the films come back, but you would like to feel like you're done.
When this film was originally made, what was it about the story that prompted you gentlemen to take over?
Well, I mean, I actually pitched The Little Mermaid quite a few years ago. I'm bad with dates, but it was shortly after Michael Eisner actually came to the studio, and they had a meeting called a gong show, which was something that Michael brought over from Paramount, where they had a bunch of people in a room. Everyone was supposed to go out and find like 3 ideas for animated features, and I went out looking for ideas for animated features, and I went into a bookstore and I started going through a book of fairy tales, and came across The Little Mermaid, and reading it, it just seemed to have a lot of the elements that you look for. It had a strong central character. It had a lot of opportunity for fantasy and great visual potential. The one thing about it that seemed like it might be a reason maybe why it hadn't been done before was that the story was so sad and it had such a tragic ending. So I felt like if I'm going to pitch this thing, I need to figure out a little different way of handling the ending. So I came up with a basic, very simple idea of making the witch more of a villainess that then led to kind of a little bit more uplifting ending, and pitched it at the next gong show, and there was interest, and that's kind of how it got started.
We discovered once we began it that actually they had considered doing The Little Mermaid in the 40s as like a featurette kind of thing, almost like as part of a Fantasia type thing. And we found artwork that Kai Nielsen, a Danish illustrator, had done in 1939, 1940, sort of blocking out the whole story. And we used some of the drawings from that as inspiration when we were developing the look of the film and the way the story was going to work out.
So then the decision was made to go ahead and do it, and then so
we wrote a script. Basically, we co-wrote the script then, and developed first a treatment, which was sort of an outline of the story that was maybe 10 pages long. And then very early on, the studio sort of paired us with Howard Ashman, the composer from Broadway who had done Little Shop of Horrors. They were sort of wooing him to work with Disney, and he was interested in animation. And they said, "Well, here's a list of the projects in animation." And he said, "Well, Little Mermaid, I really like Hans Christian Andersen. That's what I'm interested." So they sort of threw us together. We had never met Howard, but we knew his work and loved his play.
Shop of Horrors, and we thought that was great.
So we met with Howard in New York and showed him our outline of the story, and he said, "Well, this is sort of the way I see songs figuring in." And And he had an idea in the treatment that had been written initially. There was a crab character who was sort of the prime minister of the king and was kind of a stuffy guy, but he was called Clarence. He was just a sort of pompous fellow. And Howard said, you're not thinking the story is just Denmark, right? And we said, well, not necessarily. Why? And he said, well, I'm thinking the crab should be this Rastafarian. He should be this Jamaican crab and sing reggae and calypso. We're like, what? And he explained it to us a little bit more. And we said, well, we thought he was going to be this grand guy, not this laid-back guy. And he said, well, no, he could still be very grand, man, come in, you know, and very still pompous, but from the islands. And we thought, that's cool. That makes him more specific. And so when we wrote the script, then we wrote that with that idea in mind that had come from Howard. And then we sort of...
That was really also, in Howard's mind, principally, that was the way of getting these Jamaican or Calypso influences into the music, because he was looking for a way to find some contemporary influences with the music, and the crab seemed a way to work that in, and I think that really worked out nicely.
And what was good for us too is Howard Ashman and Alan Menken, the composer, came out and worked with us in California, literally in the next room over, which was sort of a throwback to the 30s system at the studio, where they had musicians right there on the lot, composers and songwriters who would work with the directors and writers right there, you know, part of the process. It wasn't like they just went away and wrote a song and came back with it. So that made it even easier to sort of integrate the songs into the story.
I mean, one of the great memories that I have of making the movie is a time when with the number Under the Sea, which eventually won an Academy Award and everything, there was a time when Howard and Alan were in one room writing that song. You could hear the notes, you could hear them working it out in the room right next to them. A couple of the storyboard artists were doing visual development of the song, and they would hear what Howard and Alan were doing. That would give them ideas for their drawings. Howard and Alan would come in and look at their drawings, and that would give them ideas for the song. And something really special came out of that, and we sort of felt like, well, this must have been what it was like in the 40s or something like that. And it was really, really sort of a special, very creative kind of environment, and very exciting.
Is it? Howard, we've lost Howard in the meantime. Why was he so special?
Well, a lot of reasons, I think, but principally, I mean, Howard was a writer, he was a director, he was a lyricist, and he didn't write music, but he knew everything about music and every musical style, and he came from a theater background, so he approached this from more of a kind of Broadway tradition than an animation tradition. One of his big strengths was not just in terms of knowing how to write great songs, but knowing how to use those songs to tell a story. It's the art of the musical. I mean, of a really good musical where the songs don't feel stuck in, but they really move the narrative along, and the story works in such a way that you can't like pull the songs out. The songs are the story, and plus, as a lyricist, I think Howard had a special gift of not just coming up with great lyrics, but in a way, there's always a problem with songs that a lot of times people just don't listen to the lyrics. I mean, they listen to the music, but with Howard, for whatever reason, I don't even exactly know how he did it, people listen to the words of his songs. They just wanted to, and that I think was very special about Howard.
Excuse me, I have a double slot, right?
Oh,
yes.
You do?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, yes. Yeah, you do.
Okay, so, all right.
Just give me like another 3 minutes, because it's 15 over there.
Okay. Yeah, but we were at 10.
Right. That's plenty right there.
Okay. Don't run out of tape in the middle.
Yeah. Well, let's get the fishies up. All right.
Make sure those fishies are swimming. Okay, cue the fishies.
I wanted to ask you, how is animation at Disney different than elsewhere?
That's a tricky question for me because I've only worked at Disney, but I do feel the approach to filmmaking is different. Disney's always had this quirky system that on paper makes no sense, and we've tried to maintain the anarchy of that system, which is to keep the system as fluid for as long as possible and to allow creative ideas to enter and to make animation the sort of acting part of the thing, the performance part, is really the centerpiece of it. And other people have come along and said, well, you know, you could do it more efficiently if you just wrote a script and then you animated that script and you painted that, and that's the more systematic, cost-effective way of doing it. But it doesn't allow for the discovery of characters, say even like in Bambi, when they discovered Thumper was this fun, neat little character, and they suddenly created more scenes to make him work. In a way, the process is a little bit like mounting a play on Broadway or something like that, and that you develop and you rewrite as you go along. You're reshaping. It's a long process of reshaping the final thing. And I think many other studios have been driven more by, like, well, you just, you know, there's certain formulaic elements or something, and then you just, you know, you write your script and you do it and you execute it and it should come out right. And it's a much more arcane, strange process.
The limitation with animated features, unlike live action features, is that we can't shoot a lot of coverage. We can't edit the film together in lots of different ways. In live action, you know, you shoot thousands and thousands of feet of film, and what you see on the screen is just a small portion. We do throw out animation once in a while, but we don't want to do that. So we really do our editing process ahead of time. But the good thing about that is we have an opportunity to put the movie up in a very rough form before we make it, because we storyboard the entire movie. We record the voices of the actors. Sometimes we do the voices ourselves if we can't bring the actors in. And we sort of slam it all together in a very rough form, and we actually can watch the movie from beginning to end, even though it isn't moving and it's not in color and it's not animated. But it gives us a sense of kind of how is it working, how is it not working, what's entertaining, what's not entertaining. And then that becomes like a piece of clay that you kind of mold and shape, and then the animation is done like almost like a jigsaw puzzle where little pieces are added and more pieces are added. And it's a very unique process. At a certain time, it seems to take on a life of its own. It's very hard to define when this rough assemblage of drawings suddenly becomes a movie and it becomes real. But there seems like there is a magical point where that does seem to happen, where suddenly now it's a movie and you're just trying to finish it, as opposed to you're not quite sure what it is yet.
Well, and the characters start sort of writing themselves once you really get animation combined with the voice. There's a magical thing that happens, and then suddenly, you know, both the animator, who's really the actor in the system, gets a sense of, you know, well, this, my character wouldn't do this, or they wouldn't do that, or whatever, and they become so identified with the character that it sort of fuses, and this synthesis really, it's like a magic trick or something that you can't, it becomes seamless. The animator, the drawing, and the voice all merge and become one thing.
Correct me if I'm wrong, is Little Mermaid, isn't it the last Disney film that was made the old-fashioned
way? That's right, you're right. Yeah, it was the last cells. Film with cells, right?
They still make cells nowadays, but that's just to sell them, I think, in galleries and things. But Little Mermaid was the last Disney animated feature where the drawings were done on pencil and paper, which is the way we still do it. But then they were transferred onto celluloid sheets and painted by hand and filmed against a painted background. Now we have digital techniques where the drawings are still done on pencil and paper, but then after that it's a whole different process where they're combined digitally, and we can do a lot of things we couldn't do then to give more depth to the scenes and simulate live action cinematography more. And that keeps evolving from film to film, but yes, it's true that Little Mermaid was the last film of its kind in that way.
Is it missed for that, or among animators?
Good thing. Well, the actual animation process isn't different. The actual acting out of the characters on paper and that performance, that's the same as it was done for Snow White. The painters have a different job. They're working with a mouse now instead of a paintbrush, and I think some of them miss that, but I think most of them, if you ask them, would you like to go back, they say no.
They would probably.
In the same sense that maybe a writer with a word processor as opposed to someone with a typewriter might say, well, gee, you know, I can make a mistake, I can fix it so easily, I can move this over here and there. It's the same with some of the painters. There's a craft, there's definitely still a craft involved, but it's a different type of craft.
I mean, at the time, this new technology was developing, and there was a question, a little bit of a question, if it would be ready for Mermaid, and in some ways, I think we felt Mermaid would be a good test for it, because with the new technology, you could simulate some of the sort of classic techniques that were a little bit too expensive at the time. And the fact was that that it wasn't ready yet, and if it had been, it was still in such an awkward stage, it might have been scary anyway. So I think ultimately we were happy with the way it worked out, but there are things that we could have done if we'd had the new technology.
Story-wise, it seems like the progression from Little Mermaid to Hercules, I mean, Hercules is a much more sophisticated story. It's more yeah. difficult story yeah. to tell to children.
Yeah.
How do you guys deal with that?
I think each story has its own demands. I do think we as storytellers have tried maybe more and more difficult things, or just giving ourselves new challenges with each film. Our next film is science fiction fantasy, and we've never really done that in animation before, and it's sort of an adventure story, and it's got different elements than these other films, and I think as artists we're always trying to stretch. I think Mermaid had an innocence about it that you almost can't duplicate in some ways, because these films have gotten to be such huge deals, and when this was made we didn't know that anybody was going to go see it, and I think that innocence seeped over into the film. We were just trying to make the film. That's a harder thing now, almost, to not look down the line and see all the promotion and the hype that these films are going to get. On this one, we didn't know any of that would happen, or that the audience would be so wide for it. So it had a peculiar sort of innocence that you can't duplicate.
It is interesting, though, that I do think, seeing the film more recently, that it does have a kind of sweetness and innocence about it. Although at the time, I think we were going for a sophistication. We were trying to bring a sort of a sophistication and adult appeal that maybe hadn't been in some of the earlier films. And for whatever reason, it's interesting how things have evolved.
My favorite character is the sea witch.
Oh yeah, yeah. Ursula, yeah. She was fun to write. Pat Carroll did a great job with the voice. But Howard Ashman originally he did the demo of her song, and he was very much the witch when he did it. So he did this whole vain thing. But she was a lot of fun to write because she could be kind of catty, and she had this basso voice, which offset, you know. We tried to make her oppose the mermaid as much as possible, so the mermaid was sweet and innocent and naive, and the witch, on the other hand, was jaded and cynical and in some ways you could argue more adult. It was a sort of a child versus the adult.
For a while, we always knew she was going to be half woman and half something, but we weren't sure what. There were early drawings where she was half scorpion fish, puffer fish, lion fish. And then someone, there again, it shows how ideas can come from different spots and influence things. Then someone drew her as half octopus, and it seemed like there's something there. There's just something creepy about those tentacles. And then actually it was Roy Disney who is very much into sailing in the sea or whatever, and was involved for years and years doing the Disney sort of nature films and underwater films. He got us a lot of footage of octopus and we sort of cut the actual stuff together. Ruben Aquino was involved with that, who animated Ursula with the song, and so you could see this kind of octopus, like he's dancing and writhing to the song, and that really kind of suggested something that seemed like it would work well.
When we were first working on the movie, Dynasty was big at that time, so we did base the way she was, her dialing that little bit, on the Joan Collins character in Dynasty. So this kind of catty, vampy thing sort of came from Joan Collins, even though she doesn't look anything like Joan Collins, but that was sort of a little thing we had in our heads as we were writing some of the dialogue on that.